Welcome to St. Paul's Lutheran Church's Weekly Worship Podcasts. As always, we're broadcasting from beautiful Grand Island, Nebraska. The following contemporary worship service was recorded on Sunday, July 24, 2016, at our 11 o'clock service. The sermon was delivered by Pastor Edgar Schaumbach. Please visit us online at www.stpaulsgi.com. We join this worship service already in progress. It is Children's Time with Pastor Edgar.
The field. Didn't own the field, he just happened to be in this field, and he bumped upon a treasure chest. And he opened it, and he said, wow, I got to have this. So he, in this case, closed the lid, put it back in the ground, covered it, went back home, got his money, and went and bought the field without telling anyone that treasure chest was in the field. So he could have not just the field, but the treasure chest in the field. And it's a story that has a point, because Jesus was saying, God's love is like that. It's like buried treasure. And guess where you find the buried treasure of God's love? Well, we can open the Bible, of course, but he's saying, it's right here in your heart, your soul. God has put his love, the treasure of his love, right here inside you. And you just need to go, oh, it's there. Open the lid and live that love that he gives you. Right here, deep inside. And we take it with us all the days of our life. We're going to pray about that, and then we're going to talk about it a little bit in our sermon. I want you to put your hand right here, remembering that the treasure chest of God's love is right here in your soul. Gracious God, thank you for your love. You have put treasure in our soul. Thank you for your love, and may we live that love all our days. Amen. Want some treasure? Gold or silver? Gold. This one's broke. You want to take one? I think I got enough for everybody. Take one. Here's another one. You got one? I know if you could sell that for a lot, but you can sure enjoy it. That one's broke. Let's get one that can go around you. There you go. There you go. Yeah, this one's broke. Thanks, guys. You have to tie that together. No, you can have it. Just tie it together. What?
Did they clean you out?
Yeah, they did. That's okay.
Of John. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves, just as he is pure. The word of the Lord.
Please stand. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 13th chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. Jesus told them these parables. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field, which someone found and hid. Then in his joy he goes and sells all that he has and buys that field. Again, the kingdom of heaven is like a merchant in search of fine pearls. On finding one pearl of great value, he went and sold all that he had and bought it. This is the living gospel of Jesus Christ. Praise to you, O Christ. You may be seated. the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. It's been my joy during the summer to share with you a series of reflections on the contemplative life. And as we've said in previous reflections, by contemplative life, we just don't mean quiet moments of prayer where we are contemplative. We're talking about it in a big way. The contemplative life that encompasses all of our life in Christ. The times of prayer and the busy everyday activity of life. It embraces the whole of our life. St. Paul says that in this journey with God, we're about growing to the full stature of Jesus Christ. The journey is about growing, about maturing in our faith. Finally, it is about becoming who we are in Christ. It's a fascinating way to put it. We're going to talk about becoming in a few moments. It's a fascinating way to put it, to become who we already are in Christ. So often we think about what we need to become in life, what we hope to be in life. And here it's being phrased in this way, becoming who we already are in Christ. This is the contemplative journey. One of the things that's very important for us in the contemplative life is to cultivate an inner awareness, to have an inner gaze that takes us into our soul. The journey with God is both an exterior journey and an interior journey. Both are important. If I were to ask you to tell me about your exterior journey, your journey through life, the places you've been, the things you've done, the circumstances of your life, you could do that. You'd have a great story to share with me. But what if I asked you, tell me about the interior journey? Tell me about the landscape of your soul, how you experience a presence of God there. What does that look like? My guess is many of us would just go, oh, I hardly know how to describe it. I'm not sure I even know the words or how to go about that. So much of our life is invested in the exterior journey and not as much attention to the interior journey. Both exterior and interior journey important to us. Jesus says in the upper room, I will not abandon you, and I'm going to send the Holy Spirit upon you to prepare a place in your heart, your soul, where I will dwell. And not only me, but I'm bringing my Father too. Father, Son, and Holy Spirit dwelling within our soul. That's why St. Paul will call us, we are a living temple, a holy temple to God, our very being. Put it a different way about our challenge to talk about the interior journey. If I asked you, tell me about Jesus, you could do that. You know the stories, right? You know the events of his life, his birth, the call of the disciples, places he's been, miracles, teachings, death, resurrection. You could tell me the story of Jesus and what that means to you. But what if I asked you, tell me about the Holy Spirit, who creates this special place for God in your soul. Oh, I know how to talk about Jesus, but how do I talk about the Holy Spirit, the indwelling Spirit within me? In the contemplative life, we want to pay attention to how we understand what goes on within our soul. And to help us do that, I've decided not to just use my words, but to use a painting, and we can put that painting up there now. It's one of my favorite works of art for spiritual reflection. I'm going to capture the lights a little bit. Thanks. Just let your eyes rest upon the painting for a bit. I'll tell you about it, and then we'll explore it. The painting is entitled Vittoria Caldoni. It's by a German artist, Frederick Overbeck. He painted this in 1821. It's a deeply spiritual painting, and I know it to be deeply spiritual because Frederick Overbeck was one of the founding members of the Brotherhood of St. Luke. And the Brotherhood of St. Luke was a group of German artists who wanted to commit their life to Christ and following Christ in the same fashion like St. Francis of Assisi. It's a very disciplined a life of giving so much of their life away to others. And they used the artwork as an expression of their faith. And you can check out more of their artwork online. Beautiful paintings, as you see here. And I'm curious, as you are drawn into this painting, where you find your eyes focusing. What's the focal point for you? My guess it's Vittoria's eyes. Were we able to, back there, to zero in on that at all? We're going to try to see if we're working on it. You might see him play with that a bit to draw it in a little closer. But our eyes, we're drawn to her eyes. And we're drawn to her eyes. It's like looking into her, not just the eyes, but looking into her soul. You see something of an inner beauty, an inner presence of God there, right? Looking deep into her eyes, looking deep into her soul, it quiets us in a way that we even become more conscious of our own soul. A very gentle beauty about her. I say it's a deeply spiritual painting, but this isn't happening in a church. Her hands are not folded in prayer. They're just drawn into a stance, a reflection, as she pauses in the work of the day. If we can expand out a little bit, you'll see she doesn't have a Bible at her feet. She has a sickle. And she's got a curious chair. She's sitting there by the roots on the sack of whatever it is she's gathered from, you know, the garden and the fields behind her. This is a pause in her working day. And she's resting. It's not just trying to recover from the heat of the day. It's like being drawn deep within her own soul. We can expand out again now. Notice that there is a peace that just fills the whole of the painting. Now, the world isn't a very peaceful place. And yet, there is a peace that just radiates through that whole painting. And I love the way the tree, you know, the roots behind her, and how that tree kind of leans to make room for her in this painting. And then that branch just wraps around her. It's almost like an image of God, of the Holy Spirit that embraces us and draws us in to a quiet remembrance of his grace and mercy. It's a moment of sitting in the glow of God's grace and mercy. She's sitting in the shadows of a tree, and yet she's aglow, right? She's not in shadows, hidden from us. She has this, as I said, a very gentle beauty about her, a gentle glow that's of God. Now, I don't know how long this moment lasted for her. At some point, she's going to get herself together, going to reach down and pick up that sickle and go back to work. And yet, she will take with her the glow of that moment with God. That beauty, that grace and mercy of God will go with her into her work. It's why we pay attention to our interior life, what God seeks to share with us, that we might then take that back into our everyday world with whatever task is at hand or with whatever people we are meeting. This is the painting. Jesus says in the parables I read to you, It said the kingdom of heaven, that's how Matthew always phrases it, kingdom of God, we often say. We're talking about that realm of God's grace and mercy that surrounds us, that dwells within, that calls us into the world. The kingdom of heaven is like treasure hidden in a field. Someone found and hid, and then he goes and sells everything that he can buy that field and have that treasure. I might add the refrain that Jesus often uses. Do you have your ears to hear this? Do you have eyes to see what Jesus is speaking about? Are you into the secret of your soul here, the wisdom that God would show you? Just in case you didn't catch it the first time, Jesus tells a very similar story right after that one. He says, well, again, the kingdom of heaven, it's like this merchant whose business was buying fine pearls, and she found the pearl of a lifetime. That rarest of rare pearls. And she sold everything else of her pearls that she might have that precious, rare find of a pearl. Again, do you have ears to hear what Jesus is saying? Do you have eyes to see it? See, what Jesus is talking about, he says, this priceless pearl, this rarest pearl, the treasure hidden in a field, why, it's right here, hidden within your own soul, waiting to be discovered. Embrace it. Give yourself to it. Come to know it. Bask in the light of God's love and glory, His mercy for you. In this way, Paul says, we grow to the full stature of Jesus Christ, basking in the glow of God's love and mercy. Not by all the things we want to do to prove ourselves to God, but just learning to cultivate that inner gaze where we rest in the glow of His mercy and grace, taking that with us then into our life. This is how we grow. This is how we mature. This is how we become. Become who we already are in Christ Jesus. Find that a fascinating way to ask, to state the matter. To become who we already are in Christ. That's a reframing of the question about our life. I think when we're young and we're starting out in life and thinking about school and eventually the careers and vocations, the callings of our life, we often go about, oh, gee, you know, what do I want to be in life? What am I called to be? You know, what's my life all about? And it's a lot of self-searching that way. But we're going to reframe that so it's not, what do I want to be? What should I be in life? But rather, who am I as God has created me? Who am I and how am I becoming what God has created me to be? That's what John says in the writing of his first letter. He's writing in his old age. He says it beautifully. He says, see. You know, see what love the Father has given us. And you see it by that inner gaze. See what love God has given you, that you should be called children of God. And that's what we are. That's what we are becoming. And what we are fully becoming hasn't been fully revealed. That's yet to be shown to us. We're still in the process of growing, maturing, the full stature, becoming who we are in Christ. And he says, but know this, at journey's end, you will be the full stature of Christ, and you will see him as he is. It'll be revealed to you, and you will know who you are in him. You'll have the full understanding of who you are in Christ. And we purify ourselves in this way. The Beatitudes say it nicely. Blessed are the pure in heart, those who have cultivated that time in their heart, their soul, to know this truth of God. That's how we purify our hearts. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. We rest in the glow of God's love and mercy. Now, when I was 5 years old, I knew exactly who I wanted to be. We all do that, right, as kids? Early on, when I grow up, I want to be. And we start that early in life. Well, when I was 5 years old, I wanted to be a fireman. My parents even bought me those big old-fashioned fireman's hats. I had a fire engine as a Christmas gift early on in life. Could sit in it and just pedal it. Those old-fashioned toys. I wanted to be a fireman. Firemen would gather down the street from where I lived. Mom would let me go down there and chat with them. They would gather down there, I think, for some maintenance on their big old fire engine. Man, I'm going to be a fireman just like them. And then later, you know, the space age started. So now I want to be an astronaut and a scientist. And then I learned I had to know a lot about math. And then I said, I don't know about that. That was not my strong suit. But I wanted to be an astronaut, a scientist. And Mom and Dad, they nurtured that idea too. I thought I knew what I wanted to be, but there was something deeper that was of God. That is true for all of us here. We all have thoughts about what we want to be, hope to be, in terms of life, but there is a deeper truth of who we are in Christ. Seventh grade, I've told this story in different ways, but seventh grade, Dad shared with me a brochure, a booklet from Concordia College in Austin, Texas. I think he was wanting to plant seeds about, you know, study hard so you can go off to college. And I'm looking at this book, and it's a place where pastors might be trained in their college education. It also had a boarding academy for high school. And I'm looking and reading about this, and something comes upon me that's not of me. It's of God. And it was the understanding, a deep understanding, that God is calling me to be a pastor. Now, that can happen early in life, and that can happen much later in life for people. But for me, it happened in seventh grade. And it was something that just unnerved me, because I had never thought of that before. And for several days, I pondered it. And then finally had the courage to tell my dad, I think God is calling me to be a pastor, and I want to go to this school, even the boarding academy. And Mom and Dad supported me in that. Notice how it shifts from what I wanted to be to something that is coming from a deeper place that is of God. What happened in that moment has been reaffirmed all along the way. As I went off to become a pastor, I thought I knew exactly where I wanted to be, what state God should put me in. It wasn't Nebraska. I grew up in the South, come on. You know, I was going to be a big city pastor, and I had dreams and ambitions, and all along the way, God does his thing of showing something deeper. And that is the way of God, not only in my life, also in your life, whatever your path may have been. It's fascinating when we embrace the contemplative life, when we take time to cultivate looking within our own soul, what we will discover. It's finally not about us at all. It's about something deeper of God in us, showing us something of our deeper, truer identity, why we're here. Basking in the beauty of his grace and mercy, just as we see in Vittoria Caldoni. Not so attentive to how we fail, how we fall short, but resting in the grace and mercy of God and discovering how loved we are. As John says, see, look within, see what love the Father has given you, that you should be called a child of God. And that is what you are, and that is what you are becoming. And the world may not operate that way. Christ does. And the fullness of who you are in Christ is yet to be revealed. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the voice and let me sing, always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages from me. Take my silver and my gold, not a mine.
And now with the whole church, we join in confessing our faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Rooted in Christ, rising to serve, we pray for the church, for the world, and for all of those in need. Faithful God, throughout diverse cultures and countries, and in spite of our differences and disagreements, your Spirit weaves us together as a church and a people. Help us all as we grow as your disciples to ask for the things that we need, confident that you hear us as we work to become and discover that life that you have created and planted within each one of us. Call us to notice places and people you created, but that we often forget or take for granted. We pray for those working in the noon heat, in the silence of the night, and in harvesting your creation. We pray your peace wherever strife is found, where homes and neighborhoods have become battlegrounds, where trust has been lost, and where people find themselves constantly in a defensive posture. Empower leaders and organizations to find solutions through persistence, faith, humility, and listening. Turn our hearts to know and share the cries of those in great need. Comfort and heal those who feel defined by an adverse situation, by grief, or by sickness. Seek after us, Lord, wherever we are found in these coming months. Grant safety to those who travel. Give Sabbath rest to those who vacation. And perseverance and strength for those who cannot find leisure time. We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting your promise to hear us through Christ our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let's take a minute to share the peace of Christ with those around us.
8 weeks from today, we'll be launching Momentum, September 11th, Rally Day at our church. We'll also be the beginning of a 10-week journey called Momentum. Now, we've shared some teasers and some short information about that program with you. It began the planning quite a few months ago, actually, and then training followed. Leadership teams have formed, and in the final 8 weeks, all of the teams that are part of planning this program of our church are heavily engaged in getting it ready. Now it comes time for us to begin thinking about it and how we will be a part of it as individuals and households. This is a first in our church, I would say, in quite a long time, in that the whole of the church, from the youngest to the oldest, is invited to be a part of it. We will be asking everyone during the Momentum journey to focus on three things. We're going to lighten the calendar in as many ways as we can here at church to allow more time for these three things that we ask of you. We want you to worship during that journey. Some of the Sundays especially will be dedicated to themes from Momentum. Not only do we want you to worship and help lead worship if that is, and serve in worship if that is your calling, but to be here that we might experience it in worship. I want you to be in faith formation programming. We have two classes that we'll be offering adults. The Financial Peace University that we often hear about, and also Legacy Journey. Next week, we'll be sharing, and also in the subsequent weeks, some information about how to distinguish what class is the right one for me. Financial Peace University or Legacy Journey. Is this a class that I would like to bring someone to from my community, or maybe my grandchildren or someone I know as well, to be a part of the journey? So we're going to be sharing that information with you so you can choose which class, and then we're going to be offering those classes through the whole of the week. There'll be a class just about on every day of the week and even some morning and afternoon times to catch you at the best possible time for your participation. Third item, very important. God is the great giver. He bestows his blessings upon us, not so we can clutch them to ourselves or be frantic about money matters, but he blesses us in ways, by small or large, so that we can give unto others with our money, with our time, our energy, our passions to make this a better place for people. And we're going to be involving everyone with a call to do mission. And you can do it as individuals through the church or on your own, or it could be a household, several households coming together, or a group. But we want everybody to make an intentional plan to be involved in mission during that 10-week journey. Worship, faith formation, mission. I'm going to share information each of the weeks and some video material as well each of the weeks in our journey up until the launch date. And this morning we got a short video we want to show you from the teacher himself of both the Legacy Journey and Financial Peace University, Dave Ramsey. Can we show that?
Financial peace. We all want it. For a while, I didn't have it. 20 years ago, I hit rock bottom. I lost just about everything. I turned to God for help, and I learned how to handle money His way. As you can imagine, it worked. That's why I started Financial Peace University. Because God's ways work. Whether you're in over your head or you're doing okay right now, if you bring home $10,000 or $10 million, if you're 21 or 61, we all need a plan. Millions of people have been through Financial Peace University. They have success stories of their own. They've learned how to get rid of debt, prepare for generations to come, and give like crazy. Your success story, your financial peace, is up to you. Now is your time. It's time to take control of your money. It's time to get ready for what God has for you. It's time for financial peace.
Classes we'll be offering along with the Legacy Journey. We hope to have a clip on the Legacy Journey in an upcoming week. I forgot to add, there's even momentum teaching material that we'll be using through our Sunday School Wave and Confirmation program. So children and teenagers, too, will be a part of that journey with us. Join me in prayer. Gracious God, pour your Spirit upon us. Open our hearts to know deeply your great love for us. You are the great giver. Help us to know your generosity of blessing to us. Lord, as we manage what you give us in our households, in our lives, in our church, teach us your ways. Give us your wisdom. Let your blessing be upon all of the leaders of the Momentum program and the teachers who will be leading classes. And let your blessing be upon our hearts as we embrace the program. In Jesus' name, amen. Please stand. We join together in the offering prayer. Blessed are you, O God, ruler of heaven and earth. Day by day you shower us with blessings. As you have raised us to new life in Christ, give us glad and generous hearts, ready to praise you and to respond to those in need.
through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share in this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Let us join hands as we pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Christ invites you to a place of honor at his banquet. Welcome to the feast. May this body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen you and preserve you in true faith unto life everlasting. Amen. We join together in the prayer. O God, as a mother comforts her child, so you comfort your people, carrying us in your arms and satisfying us with this food and drink, the body and blood of Christ. Send us now as your disciples, announcing peace and proclaiming that the reign of God has come near. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen.
Go in peace and proclaim the good news.
Thank you for listening to this episode of St. Paul's Lutheran Church's Weekly Worship Podcasts. For more information about our church, to listen to previous episodes, or to find our Facebook and Twitter pages, please go to www.stpaulsgi.com.